think at this point in time, we'll let the kids go to children's church. Sorry, Cassandra is... somebody's excited about that. It's good. It's good to be excited for children's church. And Cassandra and Chelsea are going to be leading today. So, good job. Thank you guys for volunteering with that.
As they're leaving, somebody have a bulletin I can borrow? Everybody, thank you. Which one? Let me just kind of point out some things in the bulletin. Just kind of want to highlight some things. April Horner, she is the new Celebrate Recovery leader at Isabella. And this Wednesday at 6:30, we're going to have music, and we're going to be hearing a live testimony from her. I mean, just a great, powerful testimony of how God changes lives. And so invite you to come and join us. Even if, you know, sometimes it's like, you know, I haven't been to Celebrate Recovery in a long time or supported that. Don't let that hinder you at all, okay? Just come and support some of the few that have been coming and been transformed by that ministry and continue to do that. We are starting a new men's step study tomorrow evening at 6:30 here at our church. You might know him, you might not, but just for protection's sake, we found somebody that was not from your church, not from this community, for men that wants to come and join just kind of a step study. They're meeting for the first time this Monday, so Monday at 6:30. If you feel like that's something that you could use, it's difficult to kind of know the heart of people and what they actually need without necessarily somebody saying, hey, I need this. So don't take a personal invitation to get you to come to something like that. Don't make it where somebody's actually dragging you. I know it's a lot easier for that, but maybe you just ask somebody if you need that to come along, with that. This next Sunday at 9:45, which is a normal Sunday school service, all adults and teenagers will be meeting in this sanctuary, and there is going to be a surprise speaker from your congregation, okay? And so what I want you to know is that every fifth Sunday, what we are going to try doing is this is going to be kind of a platform for people that maybe have something laid upon their hearts that they want to speak or give a testimony of God's grace and mercy and just tell a story or maybe something God's laid upon their heart that might not even relate to their own lives, but maybe to the life of the church. And so one of you is actually going to be leading that Sunday morning. And if you don't know who it is, it's probably not you. Okay, so don't be nervous about that, okay? Also tonight, we are having large groups, and which really what that format is that we come and we discuss and share kind of how God has been speaking to you through scripture and through the sermon. And so basically, if you've never attended one of those before, basically what is our attempt is to put in concrete and allow you guys to actually use that as a platform to explain or even dive even further to say, you know, sometimes whenever we leave from service on Sunday morning, you guys go take a nap and you forget what the sermon was even about. Because I want to know how I know that? Is because by Sunday night, whenever we gather together in large groups, some of you actually say, now what did you talk about this morning? And I'm like, I don't know. I wasn't there, you know. No, just kidding. But we just kind of to help us apply what we have heard, okay? Now, normally, Cassandra and I would be going on a fourth Tuesday of every month to a thing called Prime Timers. And the fourth Tuesday would be this month. But if you come this Tuesday, it's not happening. It's happening the next week. So don't get confused like Cassandra and I sometimes do on which Tuesday that it is. So it's a week from Tuesday, okay? Any theme, potluck? Is that what it is, potluck? Okay, and what I also want to tell you, I'm sorry, I'm like going all over the place with the announcements, but let's just kind of back up to tonight. At 6 o'clock, you do not have to bring a main dish. We are having hamburgers and hot dogs tonight, okay? So just bring things that complement hamburgers and hot dogs. Did you guys hear that? Okay. So that's going to be provided tonight. So, yes, thank you.
I didn't get to make the time for this bulletin, but 2 weeks from today at 5 o'clock, it will be the first Sunday in February, Melanie and I are going to meet with anybody that's interested in helping with PBS. Woo-hoo! Yep. It's in May. We're really excited. We're doing a brand new one that we got to purchase ourselves. We're not borrowing from anybody. It is going to be an awesome and fun PBS. Nick and Misty have already offered to do games and science experiments again, so we're going to be going to training in April. We're really excited, but if you would like to help with PBS, February 5th at 5 o'clock, we'll meet here at the church. We'll disclose the theme of this year's PBS. We'll have a little video to kind of show you what we're going to be exploring and kind of get started so we can start making our own decorations and prepare for that in May.
Well, have you come to church thirsty? I mean, sometimes whenever you look up on the screen and you see living water, I mean, to me, it's just like, man, I'm thirsty. So, I saw that nod, okay? Which one of you were thirsty? Oh, you were going to make an announcement?
Yes.
Go ahead. You're thirsty? Okay.
I was just going to say, you're going to our secret third, and we're going to try to pass it out next Sunday. The person that you're praying for this year. If anybody hasn't gotten a slip and they want to be a part of it, get with me after church. I've got several here. And if you have any questions about what I'm talking about, get with me after church and I'll tell you.
Prayer angels. Okay. Thank you. Water refreshing. It's good. Absolutely. You can have one. Huh? You're real thirsty? Okay. This really is not, I did not set this up. So anybody else want a bottle of water, just interrupt my sermon anywhere and just come on up and get this, okay? It really was kind of like, that's what was going to kind of happen anyway later if you haven't noticed that. But here's the thing. If you come to church this morning and you're looking for some hope, you come to the right service, because I really truly believe that what God's laid upon my heart is just filled with hope today. And so pray for me, because I want to expel hope in this place. Amen? Amen. Well, here it goes. So there's a story about Jesus and his disciples, and Jesus was invited to a wedding. And I think that that's great, that Jesus is invited to the ceremony, to the wedding. Not only that, but I think that it's great whenever Jesus is invited to the marriage. You know what I heard today? I heard that Monty and Elaine are going to be celebrating 65 years of marriage in April. And David and Melba, they've been married for 58 years. You know, and here... I just kind of want to pause and just say, I truly believe part of the reason why 65 years and 58 years is because Jesus was invited to the marriage and not just the ceremony. Amen? So Jesus was invited into a ceremony. And he was just there to kind of enjoy some stuff, you know, and he was there enjoying the celebration. And it was a Jewish wedding. There's some cues that I'm going to point out the reason why that we know it was a Jewish type of wedding. For us, whenever we have a wedding celebration, most of the time whenever I am officiating it, it's normally like 30 minutes long, max, you know, sometimes 45, if they've added some unity candles or sand or some music and stuff like that to it. But normally, you know, 45 minutes tops. These Jewish weddings, we're talking about like a week-long celebration. Anybody here like in the future, like planning like a wedding or anything like that currently? Are you planning a wedding or anything like that? Nobody willing to admit it, or nobody's just like, I sure hope not yet for my daughters, you know. But people that have been there, done that, knowing that just the celebration in our culture can be very, very expensive. So think about a week-long celebration where your close families and friends are involved for an entire week, how much money that it would take to help celebrate this occasion. And so there is food, there is wine, and all these types of goods that are being disposed about it. And Jesus, on the third day, decides that he would come and be a part of the celebration. He shows up. And by the third day, there's almost a tragedy that happens. I mean, if you were a part of this ceremony, the tragedy would be there is no more wine. There's no more wine. And so what ends up happening is that Jesus' mother is a part of the celebration as well. And she goes to Jesus. She goes to Jesus and says, Jesus, not only is there like maybe a drop or a cup left of wine, we don't have any wine. No, it's completely dry. And Jesus is like, that's not my monkey, so don't put it on my back. You know, what are you doing coming and bringing this problem to me? You know, and praise be to God. We've got a mother like Mary that would bring the problem to Jesus. And she has shown us for thousands of years why that is important. Even though it might seem minor, Mary has given us a great example of whenever we have a problem, who to bring it to. I think some of us can relate with that a little bit to say, you know, I've got this, Jesus. Problems? I've got none. Problems? I'll bring it to somebody else, but Jesus, you know, this is minor to you. So Jesus, or Mary serves as a great example of this. And so basically what Jesus says, he says, you know, that's not my problem. What are you bringing to me? And just like every mother that I have ever experienced in my life, personally, has the same type of approach to it. It's just like, you know, if you go and you sit down at a meal or something like that, and my grandmother is the same way, and so I'm glad that she's here to hear this, that whenever you sit down, you're like at a meal and you're like eating and eating and eating and you're filled to the brim and you're just like, you know, they go, would you like some more? And you're like, no, I'm full. And by the time that you say no, more stuff is on your plate. No, thank you. You're going to eat that, you know. And so it's just kind of like, this is Jesus' mother the same way. You know, Jesus says, this is not my problem. And Mary looks to the servants and say, do what he says, and then walks off. You kind of get that hint. He's already told Mary no. And then she looks at the servants and say, do what he says, and then walks off. It's almost like those little sly looks that you get from your mother every once in a while. You know, do what I ask you to do. You might be the son of God, but you're also my son. I brought you into this world, and I can take you out as well. You know, you don't like to have, I don't like to have those types of conversations. But she looks at the servants and she says, do as he tells you. And then Jesus says, he looks around, he looks at some of the resources, and there are these six vases that were used for water. And obviously, these vases were empty because he tells the servants, go fill these up. And if my calculation is right, one of the vases would be equivalent to a double of this. Okay, only one. Okay, a double what's here. So we're looking at half a vase. And what we know is that Jesus says, go fill those up. And we get these great cues from these servants, because who are these the servants of? Not Jesus. Jesus is not the master of these servants. But you want to know how they respond? They go, okay, and they go and fill up the vases. I think that there was a temptation for these servants to say, I appreciate the sentiment here, but we're not your servants. Nobody that is our boss. You're not our boss. But you know, that's the cool thing about being a servant of Jesus, is another cue that we can take in our own life is that whenever Jesus says to do something, we do it. Like that. I think that that is our heart's desire. I hope that that is our heart's desire as Christ followers. And so they go and they fill up these jugs of water. You want to know what these jugs of water were really meant for? As these people were coming in, these six jars of water were meant for ceremonial cleansing. If you want to be a part of this party, you're going to have to come into the sanctuary. You're going to have to come into the party clean. No impurities here. So when you walk in the door, these are part of the ceremony. Come cleanse your feet. Come cleanse your hand. Come cleanse your head if you need that. But ceremonial cleansing were meant for these jars. So these servants, on top of things, Jesus tells them to do something. They respond immediately with obedience, and they do it. They bring it. And whether or not that they have a ladle or whether they have a cup and they dip it out of these jars, they bring it to the master of ceremonies. And something between the cleansing of the front door of the ceremony, taking the cup or the ladle or whatever it might be to the masters of ceremonies, what was meant for cleansing, transformation happened from the cleansing to the masters of ceremonies to an element that was meant for celebration. I don't know about you, but that kind of gets my socks rolling up and down. What was meant for a cleansing now turns into an element of celebration. And it kind of reminds me just a little bit that sometimes whenever we come to church, I think that we can come multiple ways. You can come for the cleansing, but we don't stay for the celebration. We can come for the ceremony, but we don't want a part of the cleansing, and we definitely don't want a part of the celebration. We can come for the celebration, the exciting part of it, but leave out the fellowship and leave out the cleansing. And so Jesus does something miraculous as he turns the water into wine. What was meant for ceremonial cleansing now transforms into celebration. I truly believe whenever Jesus is involved, whenever Jesus is invited to the ceremony, whenever Jesus is invited to the ceremony, I truly believe that transformation can happen. And I truly believe that cleansing for you can happen today. And I believe not only that when cleansing does happen, it transforms into celebration. Amen? I've seen it happen. I'm almost going to have to start singing that song, The River. I've seen it happen in my own life. take me from dusty roads to paradise. You know, that's not just a catchy song. I truly believe that that's some of our watchword and song. And so, it kind of reminds me, this Mary that brings the problem to Jesus, these slaves that are obedient to Jesus, this transformation that happens. I truly believe all this stuff is possible for you and I. Transformation is possible if, I don't know if you got that or not. Transformation is possible if. So, I don't want you just to think that I'm making the story up, so would you turn to John chapter 2? And I'm going to read John chapter 2 just real quick. And I'm going to start with verse 1. John chapter 2. Starting with verse 1. I love hearing that noise. Call me old school. Now you guys are just doing it on purpose. appeasing the teacher. All right, you guys can move up closer. If you guys want to come to the head of the class, you guys can move up. John chapter 2 reads this. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. When the wine ran out, Jesus' mother said to him, "They don't have any wine." Jesus replied, "Woman, this is not my monkey." No, just kidding. Jesus replied, "Woman, what does that have to do with me? My time hasn't come yet." His mother told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby were 6 stone water jars used for Jewish cleansing ritual, each able to hold about 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water," and they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some from them and take it to the head waiter." And they did. The head waiter tasted the water that had become wine. He didn't know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The head waiter called the groom and said, "Everyone serves good wine first. They bring out the second-rate wine only whenever the guests are drinking freely. You kept the good wine until now." This was the first miraculous sign that Jesus did in Cana of Galilee. He revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After this, Jesus and his mother and his brothers and his disciples went down to Capernaum and stayed there for a few days. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much for your word that you have given this to us for this particular time. And it's in Christ's name, amen. Amen. Sometimes we look at this story. You know, I just want to let you know, we are part of the Church of the Nazarene, and part of the preambles and the things that what the denomination has wrestled with as far as alcohol is concerned is that we've just kind of come down to the conclusion that, you know, there's not just a great amount of benefits that comes in with social drinking. So what we just decide is, you know, we just abstain. And so I think that some of us use this story as just like, you know, I've even heard songs in which that said, you know, "I heard Jesus drunk wine, you know, and so that gives me an excuse to do it as well," you know. You guys can come to your own conclusion about that. I just want you to know what the church's stance is upon that, and it's just to abstain. And so what Jesus does is that he does this particular miracle not to stamp the approval of wine. He does it, and it says here in the scripture, he did it to just reveal this glory of who he really is to his disciples. Because now this is the first time his disciples are following him, and this is the first miraculous sign that they get to encounter is saying, "I've seen it with my own eyes." It was like a bottle of water, you know? And then all of a sudden it was transformed into not only wine, but good wine. I mean, like, it's the good stuff, right? And so Jesus says, in scripture it says that now it's about Jesus revealing his glory. That's basically what John is doing, is that he is revealing all these types of things that Jesus was doing. And at the end of his gospel, he says this, if I could tell you all the things that Jesus done, all these miraculous signs and wonders, there wouldn't be enough books in the world to fill those types of things. But I've shared this with you to reveal who he is. So, that's a great story. This transformation. Believing that whenever Jesus is invited to the party, transformation can happen. If, skip over a couple chapters. John chapter 4. Jesus and his disciples are making this journey, and they want to go the shortest distance. And you guys know the shortest distance between two points is a... And going down this distance in which that they were wanting to go, this straight line that they were going, happened to go through a very hated community and a very hated people, Samaria. And they go in there, and they are walking through this town, and Jesus excuses his disciples. They go into the town and get some supplies. And Jesus kind of stays on the outskirts of town, and it's past the time in which most people come to the well and draw from the well. except for this one lady. This one lady kind of reserves her time for later because maybe she's a little bit introverted, but maybe because that she doesn't want to be the gossiping subject or the subject of the gossip. She has some sin in her life, and some of the Samaritan ladies think that they're better than her, as the story is told. So therefore, she kind of waits until there's not this great of crowd. And she is dipping down in water, and there is Jesus, and Jesus is asking for some water. And you want to know what they talk about? You want to know the subject matter, most of the subject matter that they are talking about in this? They're talking about water. Hey, Jesus and this woman just talking about water. When we're talking about this living water, we're talking about the water that fuels the soul, that satisfies the soul, and Jesus is offering it to this woman. This woman that Jesus would even point out, saying she was full of sin. But Jesus transforms this woman. He says, woman, your sins are forgiven. Now go sin no more. And so here's the thing. I think this is kind of humorous. He sends the woman away, and she goes back into the community. And she brings people back to Jesus. She's bringing everybody that she knows. She's been forgiven of her sin. Cleansing has happened now that there is a celebration that happens. And you know what that celebration does? It brings people. Jesus has transformed a sinful woman into an effective evangelist. This is what I find very humorous about this. Because Jesus sent his disciples into town. You want to know what they brought back? Bread. Good job, disciples. This woman that was an outcast. This woman that nobody found any value at all went into town, and she became an effective evangelist, and people were transformed. You want to know what I believe? I believe the same God that can transform water into wine. I truly believe the same Jesus that can turn a sinful woman into an effective evangelist can do that for us as well. If. There's another story, just another chapter over. There is this thing, and I don't really know how to explain it. It was something miraculous that happened. There's this pool called a pool of Bethesda. And there was these people that were just plagued with illnesses, and they just kind of hovered around this place because every once in a while, legend goes that there is an angel that had stirred the water, and the first person to make it into the water whenever the waters are stirred, they become miraculously healed. And this particular person was standing there. I mean, it could be for years. You know, you couldn't get too far away from that because you might miss your healing. And Jesus, this paralyzed man that was on a mat, comes to him and he says, pick up your mat and walk. This man was hopeless. The only hope that he had was the stirring waters of the pool of Bethesda. And Jesus tells this guy, pick up your mat and walk. And you want to know what he did? He picked up his mat and he walked. He obeyed, because that's what servants do. They hear the call of Jesus and they follow his voice. And it was immediately. This hopeless paralytic was now transformed into a very healthy man. And I believe the same Jesus that turns water into wine, I believe the same Jesus who has turned a sinful woman, has transformed a sinful woman into an effective evangelist, the same Jesus that has transformed a hopeless paralytic into a healthy man, can do that for us today, if. John chapter 9, I'm going to, just one more story, okay? John chapter 9, You know, disciples are disciples are disciples. We kind of make fun of them a little bit because they're humorous. I mean, whenever you're following Jesus, you know, you don't always have it all together. Sometimes you do it for, you know, because that you're human. Sometimes you do it for your own sake. But here is the problem here. Instead of the disciples bringing a problem to Jesus like Mary did in the wedding of Cana of Galilee, they brought the problem to Jesus not because that there was really a problem, but because they brought it out of their own curiosity. Hey, here's a guy that was born blind. Whose sin? Why is he born blind? Don't only tell us why that he was born blind, but could you tell us the juicy details? I'm curious. Whose sin was it and what sin caused it? Disciples are disciples are disciples. So Jesus replies to him kind of unconventionally, because the thought as all along is that bad stuff happens because of personal sin. And what Jesus is ultimately revealing to you and I is that bad stuff happens because of original sin. And Jesus says it's not because of anybody's sin that this man is born blind. It's because God's glory is about to be revealed. And so Jesus does something unconventional, you know. Make some mud, puts it on the guy's eye, and you know what the guy, what he tells the guy to do? Go down and wash yourself down in the pool. The guy didn't hesitate, because servants don't do that, right? They do what Jesus asked him to do. Jesus tells him to do something, and he goes and he does it. And you want to know what happens? This man, this boy, now a man that was born blind, now has become a visionary. He's transformed. Life doesn't look the same anymore. Literally and spiritually. He's got a different outlook on life, pun intended. So what I believe is this. You ready? I believe the same Jesus that can turn the water into wine. I believe the same Jesus that can turn a sinful woman into an effective evangelist. I believe the same Jesus that can transform a hopeless paralytic into a healthy man. I believe the same Jesus that can transform a blind man into a visionary can transform us today. If... Hey, do you guys like the song Amazing Grace? I mean, it's the songs in which that we sing all the time. It's our faith. It's our faith that says, you know, when it really comes right down to it, can you finish this song for me? I once was blind, but... Oh, really? Is that your song? I once was blind, but... Are you telling me that Jesus did something to you? Are you telling me that Jesus is in the business of transforming? There might have been some contingencies with that, because we say the same Jesus that can do that for them can do that to us if. Are you ready for the ifs? Same Jesus can transform our lives if we are willing to admit there's no more wine. In other words, I've used my entire resources and my wine has run out. I can't do it on my own. The same Jesus can transform our lives if we're willing to admit that we can't take care of our own sin. We just can't do it. I believe that the Jesus that can do all that type of thing can do that for us if we recognize that the soul is thirsty and can only be satisfied by the true living water. If we only obey and do what he says. I mean, it's not an original thought. I didn't make up these ifs because it's sprinkled throughout each of these miracles that Jesus has done. Obeying. Bringing the problem to Jesus. Being a follower of Jesus. You might think this is a little bit corny. Okay? If you do, just live life with me anyway, okay? But I've got these waters up here, and I want this to be a moment in which that we actually physically do something in response to what we have just heard, okay? I believe that the same Jesus that does all that, I truly believe that we can experience that today. Now, you might be somebody that has come to the celebration on a regular basis, and you have been cleansed, and you've been a part of the celebration. And for some of you, you would just take a bottle of water and you're just like, thank you for making me into the person that I'm on. I am. And the path in which that I'm going on. Thank you for that. For some of you, you're just like, I'm here for the celebration, but I have not recognized that I've needed cleansing. And I believe that there's a living water. There's really no power in this. But there's power in the recognition of admitting that your wine has run out. Maybe some of us just want to have a moment where we just celebrate the goodness of God. You know, we want to be a part of something that is transforming. And so maybe we just spend just a moment in response and coming and just partaking in. And maybe, like I said, it might be just kind of corny, but some of you have already partook in this graces this morning. How refreshing that it is. It's just simply what water does. It's refreshing. It offers life. It offers cleansing. It's transforming. Jesus used it as a moment of transformation where it went from cleansing to celebration. And so I'm just asking you, if you want to celebrate today, if you want to confess today that your wine has run out, if you want, maybe God's laid upon your heart just something that's been heavy and you need to experience the living water today. I'm just asking you, would you come and would you just partake? You don't have to kneel at an altar afterwards. You just come and just have a drink with me of the living water. Amen. Would you come and be responsive to the Word of God today? cool thing about this is that there's even some stuff left over. There's enough for someone else. And so let that be maybe even a metaphor for some of us to just partake in the living water today. That we would say, yes, it is for me, but there's enough for others as well. I've got some, and I can take some to others as well. God, thank you that you are the living water. I believe that, I truly believe that we can't take care of our own sin. I truly believe that in the Christ crucified, I truly believe in the one in which that takes away the sin of the world. If we would just call upon his name, if we would just believe him, if we would just relinquish control of our life and just step into the water, the cleansing water and the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the graces in which that we have received today in the form of water. Pray that you empower us today. Pray that you empower us to share the living water with those that need it as well. If we've experienced cleansing, it's not just for our cleansing, it's for the cleansing of others. If we've experienced forgiveness, it's not just the forgiveness of for us, it's for the forgiveness of others. If we've experienced celebration, it's for the entire world to celebrate the risen Savior. So thank you for it, God. Thank you for the hope in which we have in Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, it's been my prayer all week long that the theme that you would leave with is hope. So it's my prayer that you received hope today. If anything, I hope that you can walk in the confidence of the hope of Jesus Christ. So would you go in that? Amen. You're free to go. Hope to see you guys tonight. We need some people to bring hot dog buns and hamburger buns and those types of things. We'll provide the meat. So if you guys wouldn't mind bringing that tonight at 6:00. Amen.